My name is Carol Quinn, and I'm the archivist for Jameson Whiskey. And part of my role is to share some of the incredible stories from our history with my colleagues in our brand homes here at Middleton, County Cork, where I'm based, and also at Bow Street in Dublin. But today, for Heritage Week, I'd like to invite you, the public, behind closed doors to come with me and see some of the stories from our history.
Just bringing you inside the cottage into our reading room. This is where we access archives. It's where I bring the items out from the strong rooms, which are all temperature and humidity controlled, and I lay them out here for our visitors. Now, just before we delve into some of the history, I want to show you some of the equipment that we use in the reading room. Usually, and most notably, these are what's known as book cushions. And when you're displaying a historic item, you have to be so careful that they get the correct support, especially around the spine area. And that's why these book cushions, which are from specialist suppliers, are so good. As you turn, I'm just going to move some more of my equipment. As you turn the book, the spine is always supported, no matter how many pages you turn. And that's why it is really, really important that when you're dealing with historic items, that you have the right equipment. If you're studying a page and you want to keep it open, then you use these, which are called snakes. And these are little lead pellets inside fabric. They're not going to damage the paper or the ink, but they will hold the paper open for you. Now, the sharp-eyed amongst you might have noticed that I wasn't wearing white gloves. Now, I do have them here, but I find when you're dealing with paper items, when you wear the gloves, you actually lose a lot of the natural dexterity of your fingers. And you can actually damage the pages. They can tear when you're wearing gloves. So for me, I choose not to wear them. I just make sure that my hands are very, very clean, which at the moment isn't very difficult as we're all washing our hands. Where I would use the gloves is if I was dealing with photographic items or works of art. You see here in our reading room, we're looking out to the glorious grounds of the old Middleton Distillery or brand home here. All our windows have UV filters, so there is no damaging rays coming in from the lights. The same with our ceiling lights, we have UV filters there as well. Everything that's here is here to stay.
Okay, so I'm going to now talk you through some of the key items from the archive that I hope you're going to find interesting. I'm often asked, what's the oldest item, or what's the most valuable item, or which is your favourite item? And it's very difficult because it's the collection as a whole. Just one thing doesn't give you the complete story, but there's a couple of things that kind of really make you gulp, I think. So I've taken a few of those out, so come with me.
I'm going to start by showing you something that's incredibly precious to us here at Jameson. This is the pocket notebook belonged to this man, let me reveal his name, John Jameson. Now he is the son of our founder and he is the son in the name of the firm, John Jameson and Son. And like his father and many other members of his family, he was a hands-on distiller. And this is his pocket notebook from 1826, that when he was distilling Jameson whiskey at Bow Street, this is him writing down the actual mash bill, which is the recipe for whiskey, and recording what was going to be the beginning of a whiskey that was going to conquer the world. And for me to actually see this, and for the people who work in our brand homes and share our stories, to have this tangible link by looking at the actual physical handwriting. This is something that John Jameson touched and held on to as he was creating his world famous whiskey. It's something that's so incredibly special to us. Now, when we first found this within our archive, it was in very, very poor condition. And before it could be handled or displayed, we needed to send it to a paper conservator. So I chose Paul Curtis, who works in Muckross Bindery, that's located at Muckross House in Killarney, because Paul is an expert in the field of paper repair. And he had to take apart this little notebook and effectively rebind the leather. And when he did that, something wonderful fell out. Trapped within the pages were these. They're actual grains of barley from the Bow Street Distillery in 1826 when John Jameson was distilling whiskey. That is the most wonderful link to our history that I can imagine. One of the things that really astonished me when I started my job and looking through the records was how global Irish whiskey was, you know, even 100 years ago. There was no part of the world, really, that it wasn't sold in, and that was something that I wasn't expecting. And I know this through records such as this little book here, which is actually a label book. Now, this is something that you'd still find in Fox and Geese, in our bottling plant, and the man in charge of ordering labels, he kept this book so that he had a copy of every label that was used. But what is great for us is that he's kept them for all the different territories. So if I just go through it, now this is very fragile because the paper is very poor quality, so it's quite acidic. But you can see all these labels, these are a gold mine for the brand teams and the marketing teams in terms of coming up with new reiterations and new packaging designs. So I'm just going to scoot through it to here. And we find these are the labels for the American bottling. And they had a very specific importer. Now, this is the era, this is about 1900s up to about 1930s. It was always this company, W.A. Taylor & Co. New York. And so if you get a bottle of Jameson just about pre-prohibition or just after it, and if it doesn't have W.A. Taylor on it, then it mightn't be real. And this one I absolutely love. It is a Jameson label for 1914 for Honolulu. They were selling enough in Honolulu that they needed a specific label. That just kind of, that blew my mind really. Other territories that, you know, we're happy to be getting back to. We have India. Here are the special labels there for India. And when you go through this book, towards the end, you can see here he's written where all the export labels are going to, what the designs are, everything like that. And as I say, this is an absolute gift and a gold mine for our brand teams. This is a very nice font if anybody wants to use that. This is a private bottling with Mr. Andrew Jameson's compliments. I just want to take a moment to show you what the Jameson Bow Street Distillery looked like at its height. Anybody who's been to the brand home might know where it is, on the original site since 1780. If you're familiar with Dublin and you know the forecourts, it's just behind there on Bow Street. And by the 1880s, it was vast. It reached over 6 acres of Dublin city centre. And it's literally, it is like a small town, self-sufficient within the city of Dublin. And within those walls, there were over 200 men working at any one time. And there was a range of crafts. We think of coopers, we think of distillers, but there was ostlers, there was saddle makers, there was leather workers, there was brick workers, there was slaters, there was carpenters. And you see in this lovely little image here, little wagons there of dragging whiskey through the streets of Dublin. The carpenters and the blacksmiths within the distillery would have made those wagons and all the metal fixtures that they needed. It was completely self-sufficient. Now, I just want to show you something that I think is very, very special, and it speaks a lot to the history of our values of our company. We all know our values of real, remarkable and responsible, but where did they come from? You know, they didn't just appear out of nowhere, and I think this is an important story to share. So what you're looking at here, I'll just pull back a little bit, this is a wage book from Bow Street, and it does what it says on the tin. Here you have a list of everyone who's working there, and the highest paid of the guys on the ground, we'll say, was the miller, because he grinds the barley to make grist. So if he goes wrong in the beginning, it's very hard to pull back. And here you have everyone, the crew working in the still house, the back house, the floatman, he's the guy driving the wagons around Dublin City, bringing the barrels of whiskey to customers. And what is marked is the days they work and how much they're paid for. And this is a rich seam of information, especially for genealogy, for people looking up their family history. But what I want to draw your attention to is the date of this one.
So it's the 28th of April 1916. This is Easter weekend, and this is the beginning of the Easter Rising in Dublin. And you may not be aware, but Bow Street was actually taken over by the rebels. Now, it was a long weekend, and luckily there was no distilling going on, so there was nobody harmed when it was taken over. There literally was very few people on site, and they were just told to remove themselves immediately. And the rebels barricaded themselves into the distillery. And they took the distillery because it was very strategically placed between North King Street and the barracks, the British Army barracks to the north of North King Street, and the River Liffey, and the docks, which got you into the city centre very quickly. And it was a scene of absolutely horrific violence and hand-to-hand fighting. For a lot of the residents on Bow Street and the area around Church Street, they witnessed scenes of unimaginable brutality. You had soldiers rampaging down those streets, kicking doors in, pulling out any male they could find, battering them, shooting them in front of their family. I mean, I think the post-traumatic shock, the legacy of that is really not understood. And for a lot of the people living in that area, they worked in Jemison and they could not get into their workplace and were severely traumatized. Now, what this meant at that time was legally, if you didn't turn up for work, you don't get paid. That's the law. And the best example of this that I can tell you is the Titanic. And when the Titanic went down, when it actually sunk, whatever that time was, that's when the wages of any of the survivors' employees, you know, the wait staff, the stokers in the coal room, the engine drivers, that's when their wages stopped. So when those poor traumatized survivors went to even claim their last week's wages from the company, they were only given a pittance. And for the descendants of the poor people who drowned, they weren't even given the wages either. So this was the norm. It was the norm to do that. So for these people whose families depended on them, they couldn't get into work. So to add to the violence they're witnessing, there is this trauma. Are they going to get paid? Are they going to be able to feed their families? And what you have is this little pencil note up here. It says, "Rebellion in Dublin, all employees paid full week." And it just goes to show our company values of being real and being responsible were certainly in play in Easter 1916. Archives for me are really about people. And I love trying to get into the history and the lives of the people who worked in Bow Street, generations, fathers, sons, grandsons, all working together. What was it like, you know, in there? And it wasn't a staid or a dull sort of place, because there could be upwards of 200 people working at any one time. And people, as I'm sure everyone knows, are complicated and things don't always run smoothly. So that's why I brought out this lovely little article. It's the punishment book from the Bow Street Distillery. So if you have a look here, punishment book, being a record of the punishments awarded for misdemeanors from the 1st of January 1949. Now, there were certain things that just couldn't be tolerated. Punishment book to our ears sounds very harsh, but you know, when we look into it, you'll find there's a bit of humanity as well. Now, you'll pardon me just one second as I turn the page. Of course, there are names here that I really don't want to be broadcasting, so I'm just going to cover that part and then we go back into the book. So there were a number of things that really just couldn't be tolerated in a distillery. And when you look down to the punishment book, you might think that, okay, stealing whiskey might be the number one crime, but it's not. When you look down, it's smoking. And of course, this is really dangerous. When you have somewhere with huge volumes of alcohol, fire is an ever-present danger. You really just can't turn a blind eye to somebody smoking behind the stills. When you visit our brand home at Bow Street today, the original site of the Jameson Distillery, you can still see the blackened beams from various fires over the years. It was an ever-present threat. So what do you do if somebody's determined to have their sneaky cigarette? Well, the easiest thing to do when you catch somebody would simply be to suspend them or stop their wages.
But this isn't just punishing the man or the transgressor. This is punishing their family, because they would have been the breadwinner. So the Jameson management really didn't want to do this. So they hit on a great scheme. Traditionally, in the Bow Street Distillery, you got your daily grog. That was a glass of whiskey that you'd get at the end of your shift. And it's something that you'd look forward to and you'd be queuing up in anticipation of getting. So what they do when they find somebody who is smoking behind the stills is they cut their whiskey. Whiskey cut for a fortnight, whiskey cut for 2 weeks. And when I look through the pages of this punishment book, no one's name crops up twice. Watching all your buddies getting their free glass of Jameson whiskey, and you had to stand there, you know, with your mouth hanging open, was enough. You never transgressed twice. And your family wasn't punished for your misdemeanor. As well as what you'd expect, you know, the records of distillation, wage records, sales to customers, invoices to farmers. Occasionally, something that you don't expect arrives in the archive. What this is a petty cash book for Bow Street. And it's all those little things, you know, you just need to run out for a stamp or, you know, a pot of ink or something like that. It's all the small incidentals. And what I absolutely love about it is if you go down here and we're looking down, and these are all the, as I say, the small little purchases, and I'm just zooming in on this one here. Cat's milk for 6 months. They kept cats on the payroll in Bow Street because back in the day, the biggest building in any distillery was going to be the grain store, and you took the grain in once a year at harvest time. And this was a cornucopia. This was a feast day for any mouse that was passing. Mice like grain. And you don't really want mice in the grain that you're using for your whiskey. So you need to bring in the professionals. And they did. They brought in the cats. And so you would have had cats specifically kept at Bow Street and at Middleton as pest control. And you have to keep them on the premises and you keep them happy. So they had their own petty cash heading for their milk.
Well, I hope you enjoy that, our visit behind closed doors. And if you're interested to learn a little more about the fascinating history of Irish whiskey, we have a podcast. It's called A Story of Irish Whiskey, in which you'll learn about the ups and downs of this incredible industry. And as a special treat for Heritage Week, we'd like to invite you to visit us at our brand homes in Middleton, County Cork, and Bow Street in Dublin, and use our discount code VISITUS to get a special 20% off. You can book your tickets online on our website at jamesonwhiskey.com, and don't forget, visit us. Thank you.